Hi everybody, my name is Mike Kelly, and today I'm going to talk to you about the very controversial practice of the use of grading floors. This practice is something I'm seeing debated across the country. I even see it pop up on social media where teachers are saying they're leaving the profession because they're being forced to give grades that they don't feel students have earned. And I understand that frustration. If a student doesn't turn in their work or demonstrate their knowledge, it feels unfair that we would award them any points, a 50 out of 100 or whatever a grade floor may be set at. And I understand that frustration. But I also understand where the idea behind the use of grading floors comes from. We have to understand that the 100-point scale is very flawed. So for an A, we have a scale of 90 to 100, a B, 80 to 89, a C, 70 to 79. These are all 10-point increments. And then we have this F scale that is 0 to 60 or 0 to 65 or 0 to 69. And that just doesn't seem to make sense. And the truth is it doesn't, mathematically or when it comes to accurately reflecting student knowledge. So many schools have tried to adjust and fix this by adding in the use of grading floors. So I understand where that idea comes from, and it may be the best practice some people can think of or they have developed so far in order to address this issue of the really detrimental effect of zeros and also the flaws of the 100-point scale. But I'm going to provide you some alternatives here today where I feel like we could accurately reflect student knowledge and skills, because that's what a grade really should do. And also, we could make sure we're holding students accountable to their learning. Again, it's not just about doing the work. It's about students having the opportunities to demonstrate their learning. So again, I believe a grade should accurately reflect the knowledge and skills a student possesses or is able to demonstrate. And here are some ways in which I feel like we can do that without the use of a zero and without the flaws of the 100-point scale. So first and foremost, I'll start out by saying we need to stop grading behavior and stop grading practice. So classwork, homework, everyday work inside the classroom where students are building their knowledge and skills, that should be assessed formatively. And what I mean by that is on a daily basis, we should be checking for understanding, we should be providing targeted feedback, and we should be following up with students that need additional assistance. We should be doing that on an everyday basis. And that will prevent students from falling too far behind. And we're also making sure we're providing intervention in a timely manner to keep students up to pace with the rest of the class. So that's the first step in terms of practices we can do to fix this as an alternative to the use of a grading floor. The second thing would be, let's only grade our tests, quizzes, projects, and essays, those summative assessments. And there might be some other things in there we would grade as well. But really, we should be grading only summative assessments. Those assessments should be aligned to our standards or our anchors or our learning objectives, whatever your school chooses to do. And they should be balanced accordingly. And I've talked about balancing and weighting assessments in previous videos. You could check out my YouTube channel for those. But I'm just going to say we need to remove the everyday practice and behavior and only include the summative assessments in a student's grade. From there, again, I believe we need to build in, the third step of this would be to build in an assessment cycle when it comes to planning our units. And what I mean by that is we may reach a point where we formally assess a student in a summative manner, and that could be a test, a quiz, a project, an essay, a debate, many different things. But we also need to build in time after that point to provide additional feedback, additional follow-up, practice, whether it be independent or with other students, and then another opportunity for students to demonstrate their knowledge and skills. So that might be a retest, it might be another opportunity to present information. We can do them in alternative manners to give students opportunities that they may be more comfortable with. But really, we need to provide that opportunity after the first assessment. And again, that's a controversial practice, the idea of retesting, although I don't think it should be. That is something that's absolutely essential to make sure students are being held accountable to their learning. And again, that's an important piece. If we're just giving them a one-and-done assessment and they have no more opportunities to show their learning afterward, we're missing really the idea behind we want students to learn the knowledge and skills we're putting before them and we're helping them explore. And if we're not doing that, we're really deciding to cut off opportunities for students, and that's never okay. So just to recap, We need to stop grading practice and behavior. We need to make sure we're checking for understanding, providing targeted feedback and follow-up on a daily basis. And then when we do summatively assess the things we are including in the grades, we are designing an assessment cycle that includes time after the initial summative assessment for additional feedback, follow-up, and practice, and then an opportunity for students to reassess or demonstrate their learning in another manner. If we're doing those things, we're not going to have zeros in our gradebook in the first place to worry about a grading scale. Though there will be no need. The exceptions will be few and far between, and really the majority, if not all of our students, will be keeping pace with our class and also be able to demonstrate understanding, and we'll be able to stand behind the grades we are then assigning them, or the grades our students have earned, really. And it becomes more accurate. So again, I understand the idea behind the use of a grade floor from a school's perspective, but I also understand the frustration teachers have when they feel like they're just being asked to give out points or assign points for something that a student didn't do or knowledge they didn't demonstrate. I feel like if we use these practices, we accomplish the ultimate goal of supporting student learning, providing them opportunities to demonstrate that learning, and also to accurately report their grades out. I hope you've enjoyed this talk. Again, please feel free to comment and share your thoughts on the topic. Have a great day.
Yeah.